savings from changes to programs. See AFN.net for more. Former Trump official Ken Cuccinelli wants Governor Ron DeSantis to run for president.
Governor DeSantis has a proven record defending freedom, defending parental rights, and defending the unborn, defending our children. And Governor DeSantis has acted to protect our children from Disney like no one in history. He's stood up to the radical education establishment and their woke politics that they have brought into the classroom. Under his leadership, Governor DeSantis has made Florida the number one destination for Americans looking for more freedom and a brighter future.
Cuccinelli was Deputy Secretary of Homeland Security during the Trump administration. A former attorney for one of the January 6th defendants says our justice system is so compromised that it has been rendered a vile, disgusting mess by a Department of Justice running amok. AFN's Chad Groening explains.
On Wednesday night, Fox News Channel host Tucker Carlson interviewed the ex-lawyer for Jacob Chansley, the Navy veteran who has been dubbed the QAnon shaman by the mainstream media. Chansley was arrested and federally charged for, quote, knowingly entering or remaining in any restricted building or grounds without lawful authority and with violent entry and disorderly conduct on Capitol grounds. He was sentenced to nearly 4 years in prison. Albert Watkins said the footage proves Chansley did not have all the evidence to decide whether he should go to trial or take a plea. He ultimately took a plea. Watkins called Chansley's prison sentence a tragedy and a dagger at the heart of our American justice system.
This is about our justice system being so compromised. The very integrity and core of that which we wore as a badge of honor for the entirety of our nation's history has been rendered a vile, disgusting mess by a Department of Justice that was running amok. And they didn't share the video of my client, the footage of my client with nine officers surrounding him peacefully, wandering about, trying to help him, trying to get him access to the Senate chamber. They didn't because it didn't fit their narrative.
I'm Chad Groening.
A pro-life leader in New Mexico contends the legislature has gone even more to the left than it had been. Charlie Butts reports.
The New Mexico legislature has passed the Reproductive and Gender-Affirming Health Care Freedom Act. Elisa Martinez of the New Mexico Alliance for Life considers it to be the nation's most radical infanticide, abortion, transgender measure. She tells AFN Republicans tried desperately to challenge it.
Multiple amendments were offered to try to address some of the serious concerns in this bill, including the infanticide portion, which mimics language from the California law that really shocked the nation recently. That was voted down.
The language would allow killing a baby within 28 days after birth.
Also, a parental involvement requirement was voted down, and also, you know, a mandate that this bill is going to require for gender-affirming healthcare models that have failed throughout all of Europe was also addressed in an amendment that was voted down.
So AFN asked, if a teacher says something against abortion or transgender treatments and mutilation surgery to a student, or a teacher, in fact, can they face charges?
The bill applies to any public body that receives public funding. So yes, it applies especially, specifically, I believe the target is schools and our children.
Governor Michelle Grisham has been a champion of the bill and is expected to sign it. I'm Charlie Butts.
That is all for now. We appreciate your listening. See AFN.net for more. For American Family News, I'm Robert Thornton.
Greetings, everyone. I'm Dr. Matt Ayers, president of Wesley Biblical Seminary. Did you know that there's a way to attend seminary where you don't have to write papers and you don't have to get graded? When you audit a course, you get to participate in the course and learn without earning the degree. You can sign up to audit any course at Wesley Biblical Seminary for only $250. Whether it's discipleship or the Old Testament or theology, you can audit a course this coming semester. Go to wbs.edu to sign up to audit. That's wbs.edu.
Darkness is not an affirmative force. It simply reoccupies the space vacated by the light.
This is the Hamilton Corner on American Family Radio.
It should be uncomfortable for a believer to live as a hypocrite.
Delivering people out of the bondage of mainstream media
and the philosophies of this world.
God has called you and me to be his ambassadors, even in this dark moment. Let's not miss our moment.
And now, the Hamilton Corner.
Well, don't mind me. I'm just grooving a little bit. Just a little groovy going on. Welcome to the Hamilton Corner, ladies and gentlemen. I'm your host, Abraham Hamilton III. Oh, I got a lot to unload today. I'm going to run out of time for sure today before I run out of show. My goodness. You tuned into the Hamilton Corner. I'm joined by the Corner Contingent. One down, but there is no frown because, as I said, I got a lot to unload. So I'm just going to tell you now, we're not going to get to any callers today. It's not gonna happen today. Right across from me, my man, 100 grand, Mr. Bobby Rosa, who's wondering why Dr. Redfield wasn't interviewed as often as Dr. Fauci was. But we'll get to that in a moment. We'll get to that. In the screening room, producer extraordinaire, the real J. Mizak, often imitated, never duplicated. You know what it is. He's ready to rock and roll with today's program as well. We are in the middle, not the middle, but we're continuing our fast. For all of you who, Hamilton Corner listeners and viewers, who've made the decision to join us as we're fasting for the state of affairs in our nation, asking the Lord to show us the plague of our own hearts, to aid us in being ambassadors of his glorious kingdom, starting right in our own homes, in our neighborhoods, and ultimately on behalf of our nation. I don't know about you, but the Lord is answering these prayers, I can tell you. Oh, boy, I have to tell y'all. Eventually, but the Lord's like, oh, hey, looky here. Hey, looky here. It's like, oh, yes, Lord. And I have to tell you, man, I'm grateful for the Lord's conviction. You know, as I've said on this program, the Lord says he chastens those whom he loves. And I really bask in the Lord's correction as an expression of his love, man. It's fantastic. But I would encourage you to join us, man. However the Lord leads you to fast, that is between you and the Lord. The only encouragement is that you are consistent with it. We will continue through the end of the month of March. And also, I want to encourage you to make sure that your times of fasting are accompanied by prayer. And we don't want to, we're not trying to diet in the name of the Lord. We're trying to fast and pray. Man, so much is happening in our nation. And as I say all the time, man, if the Lord can get a hold of us and our families and in our homes, there's no question as to what he could do in our nation. At this very moment, many of you are making that transition from your part-time jobs where you generate an income to your full-time jobs where you cultivate an outcome. And as you make that transition, I want to encourage you to do so with full intentionality, understanding the primacy that God places on family. Family is his institution. This is the first institution that God ordained and established when he unfolded human history and recorded it for our benefit and edification. What goes on in your house is far more important than what goes on in the White House. Even in times when you have an occupant of the White House, when we all know, let's just be real, he ain't running the country. It's not. He's not. But thankfully, there is one who supersedes him. Mm-hmm. And that is who we place our faith in. This is the transcendent, resurrected King of glory, Yeshua, HaMashiach, Jesus, who was, who is, and who is to come again. Today, we're going to delve into the book of Nahum. Nahum. Mm-hmm. When was the last time you spent some time studying the book of Nahum? The book of Nahum is really like a sequel to the book of Jonah. All right. If I were a movie maker, I'm telling you, I'd make a movie from Jonah and Nahum. I got sequels already written for me. The script is already prepared. Nahum ministered from about 663 to 612 BC. Now, that is important because you may recall the Assyrian Empire conquers the northern kingdom of Israel in about 722 BC. Remember, in BC, you kind of count down to zero, and then you start again AD, right? The two major events in Israel's history, the conquest of the northern kingdom under the Assyrian Empire, the capital city of Assyria was Nineveh, all right? Nineveh is actually located where modern-day Mosul, Iraq is, all right? Then you go a little further into history to where the southern kingdom of Judah Its conquest culminates in 586 BC, but it starts in earnest at about 605 BC, which is why the scripture refers to Daniel and his friends, Azariah, Hananiah, and Mishael, as some of the first of the exiles, because it was actually an attrition-like exile. It wasn't just a blitzkrieg affair, all right? We're going to turn to the book of Nahum, chapter 3, verses 8 through 13. And the reason, well, not only the reason, you're going to see Nahum Chronicles was described as the fall of Thebes, or verse 8 says, no Amon. The city of Thebes was the capital city of Egypt. And that serves as a background for the book of Nahum, because in this portion, the Lord is prophetically pronouncing judgment on Assyria and upon Nineveh as the capital of Assyria. Oftentimes, Nineveh is referred to as representative of the entire nation. Okay. And Nahum serving as a sequel to the book of Jonah, it underscores the fact that the repentance that the Ninevites engaged in under Jonah's ministry, dare I say initially reluctant ministry, did not last long term. Kind of like repentance in Judah and Israel didn't last long term. But it lasted for only about 40 years. All right. So serving as a sequel to the book of Jonah, Nineveh's repentance didn't last beyond about 745 BC. When you put that on the timeline with the book of Jonah, it's about 40 years. When in 745 BC, that's when Tiglath-Pileser III made Assyria the leading military power in the Near East, which is shortly before their ultimate conquest of the northern kingdom of Israel. I'm saying all of this for a reason. Let me just give my plug here. Everybody who is listening to me, I would heartily encourage you to make sure that you incorporate biblical history in your instruction to your family in world history. The Bible is not a history book, but it is a book that includes history. And you can place these events, these times to help your children, your families, and even yourselves to understand that these are real people, real places, and real events that the Lord allows his prophets to highlight before it's happening. I mean, the book of Daniel is amazing in its prophetic declaration of world history. I mean, the Greeks, the Romans, the Medes, the Persians. I mean, it's amazing. And this is one of the things that can be utilized to elevate and highlight the scriptures being authoritative and dare I say, dominant even over some of the myths from other religions. But that's just an aside. I'll let you know we teach history, world history, fully including the Bible. And we literally describe history as his story. It is his story how he has intervened in the affairs of men and ministered to and through men. Some rebelled, some yielded and submitted. But this is his story. All right, getting to the text. I'll read it, then I'll unpack it a little bit. Nahum chapter 3, verses 8 through 13. Here we go. Are you, referring to Nineveh, are you, Nineveh, better than No Amon? Some translations there say Thebes. King James, I believe, has populous No. These are all synonyms for the capital city of Egypt, Thebes. Why is that? Because the Assyrian Empire conquers Egypt, conquers Thebes. So the Lord is saying through Nahum to the Ninevites after they already experienced a brief time period of repentance under Jonah's ministry, and then they're coming back around, and the Lord is looking at them over his glasses, proverbially, through Nahum, saying, are you, Nineveh, Assyrians, better than Thebes, Egypt, which is the land that they had just conquered? Because the Assyrian Empire conquers Thebes and Egypt in 663 BC. All right, let me keep going. Are you better than No Amon, which was situated by the waters of the Nile, with water surrounding her, whose rampart was the sea, Mediterranean Sea to the north, Red Sea southeast, whose wall consisted of the sea? Ethiopia was her might, and Egypt too without limits. Put and Lubim were among her helpers. Lubim is a reference to Libya, which is west of Egypt. Egypt. Verse 10, yet she, Thebes, Egypt, became an exile. She went into captivity. Also, her small children were dashed to pieces at the head of every street. They cast lots for her honorable men, and all her great men were bound with fetters. You too, Nineveh, Assyria, will become drunk. You will be hidden. You too will search for refuge from the enemy. All your fortifications, or some translations there say fortresses, all your fortifications are fig trees with ripe fruit. When shaken, they fall into the eater's mouth. Behold, your people are women in your midst. The gates of your land are open wide to your enemies. Fire consumes your gate bars. Now, what is the Lord saying here? The Lord is pronouncing judgment on a nation who he had previously extended grace to through the proclamation of repentance through Jonah, only to see them turn away yet again after that. And then the Lord uses as a tangible representation, an exhibit A, if you will, as to how mighty nations are conquered. He uses an experience the Ninevites, the Assyrians, would be aware of firsthand, because they know that when Thebes was plundered, when Thebes was toppled, guess who was the instrument of its toppling? The same Assyrians whom he's talking to. He explains the natural fortifications that they had. Thebes was situated by the waters of the Nile. I mean, having a flowing river flowing through the middle of your nation had the capacity to provide all manner of resources and wealth and riches. And having as ramparts the sea, you know, having as walls the seas. The Lord is describing that this is a place where, geographically speaking, it wouldn't be easy for this place to be overthrown. But what the Lord is revealing in all of this is there any fortification without the grace of God? And I am saying, and I'm pointing this out for several reasons. The chief reason I'm pointing this out today is to underscore a point I've made time and time again. A thriving economy does not make a nation great. It doesn't. Being a constitutional republic with democratic features doesn't make a nation great. If Ichabod is declared over our land, there is no hope for our land. Which, as an aside, when Ichabod was born, who was a real person, by the way, he was the grandson of Eli, the descendant of one of Eli's wicked sons. And Eli's daughter-in-law died the same day that he died. And Ichabod is often described and translated as the glory is departed, but actually the literal Hebrew rendering is the glory has been exiled. The glory has been exiled. The greatest need for our nation is repentance. It's repentance. I thank God for our constitutional governmental structure. It's the greatest republic in the history of the world. But even the greatest republic in the history of the world, if it persists in rebellion against God, we will be filed into the dustbins of history, just like Thebes in Egypt, just like the Assyrian Empire, just like the Persians, the Medes, the Roman Empire, the Grecian Empire. We must not be so arrogant to think that what has happened throughout history cannot happen to us here. And as an aside, the Lord mentions that the fear that would take the once mighty Assyrians would have them quaking like women. You want to call God a chauvinist? He's simply saying warfare is the realm of men.
The primary way whereby God talks to all of us is through his word.
Pastor Joseph Parker.
When you read and study the word of God, the God of the universe, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit are all speaking directly to us. So if you wonder, well, how do I listen to God? Reading and studying the word of God is a very big and major way whereby God will speak. But along with the word of God, the Holy Spirit speaks to believers every day as well. So we're to not only listen to the Word of God, but we're listening to the Holy Spirit. As the Holy Spirit speaks to us, often He may speak through thoughts in your mind or a guidance and direction and impressions that you receive in your spirit. But the Holy Spirit really does speak to all of us every single day. As you receive guidance and counsel from the Word of God and the Holy Spirit, do what you're told.
Joseph is host of the Hour of Intercession, heard weekday mornings at 3 Central Time. Find the podcast at afr.net.
Let's see, if something costs less, but people are happier with it, that sounds like something to look into, and that's MediShare. Maybe you've heard switching to MediShare to pay for healthcare can save the typical family $500 a month, and that's huge, but it's also true that people are way more satisfied after making the switch, too. The customer satisfaction rate for MediShare is double that of the typical health insurance plan. Double. MediShare works. It's been around for more than a quarter century, and members have shared more than $3 billion of each other's bills. People love having telehealth and a huge nationwide PPO network. So, yeah, you can save a ton and like it better. Imagine being happy with how you're taking care of your health care. So if you're self-employed or part of the gig economy, or you just want a plan you're happy with, you can call right now and get a price within 2 minutes. A very, very smart use of 2 minutes. Here's the number you need. 833-44-BIBLE. That's 833-44-BIBLE. 833-44-BIBLE.
We're in the financial business. We manage a couple of trusts and some estates, and of course, our own monies too.
Courtney Trotter talks about the charitable gift annuity from the AFA Foundation.
I understand annuities about as much as anyone, I guess, can. So I just felt the charitable gift annuity was a win-win situation for many people that still are generating income and still have assets. Because you never know when you may have to draw down on something like that. And if you don't ever have to, then it's even a better gift to get to a really good foundation like AFA. A very solid investment, a good way to help do the Lord's work, and it's there to help us as well.
Find out if the charitable gift annuity can work for you by calling the AFA Foundation at 800-326-4543, extension 345.
Shining light into the darkness, this is the Hamilton Corner on American Family Radio.
Welcome back to the Hamilton Corner, Abraham Hamilton III here. As I mentioned yesterday, we are collecting listener stories as our spring share-a-thon is right around the corner. If the Lord has ministered to you through American Family Radio, this program in particular, or the entirety of the network, however God has blessed you through this network, we'd like to hear from you. What we're asking you to do, if that is you, simply to call this number, 877-876-8893. I'm going to say it again a bit more slowly. I can hear my wife. Abe, slow down. 877-876-8893. You will leave the equivalent of a voice message. Our production staff will get that message, produce it up, and you may very well hear your voice during Share-a-thon as we play various listener testimonies. So you're welcome to do that. We love hearing from you. We are encouraged by it, but we most are interested in allowing your words to encourage other listeners and viewers like yourselves. So the number again is 877-876-8893, and we would love to hear from you. All right. Oh, boy. Got a fully loaded deck today. Fully loaded deck. Now, I believe it was Tuesday when I played for you some of the video from the Raw January 6th footage that Tucker Carlson played on the Fox News channel. And many of you may recall the most pressing question I had as an attorney who's practiced major felony prosecution at the trial level for a decade. I mean, the stuff they show on Law and Order and the television shows, that's what I did for a decade, prosecuting major felonies, murder, homicide, armed robberies, sexual assault, you name it. I prosecuted those. The question that I was left with was this. Has any of these defendants, have any of the defendants, the January 6th defendants, people who were charged with crimes related to January 6th, though no one was charged with the federal crime insurrection, I find that laughable that the narrative continues to assert that people were committing insurrection. That is literally a federal crime that nobody was charged with. The overwhelming majority, I believe it's close to 1,000 people who have been charged with crimes related to January 6th, the overwhelming majority of which amount to criminal trespass, which is a misdemeanor. All right. It is an extreme minority who's even been charged with any felony offenses, if any at all. I believe this Jacob Changeley, the described as the QAnon shaman, whoever, he was one of the few who pled guilty to a crime. And I asked the question, did he and his fellow defendants, had their attorneys been presented this footage that was in the possession of the government? I asked that question because any prosecutor from sea to shining sea in this country will tell you that the law requires every prosecutor to turn over to the defense any exculpatory evidence, meaning evidence that could show that the party charged with a crime may very well not be guilty of that crime, or any mitigating evidence. That would be evidence that though the party may be guilty, there is evidence available to the government that shows that the sentence should be reduced, should be mitigated by this evidence. The law requires the prosecution, in this instance, the assistant U.S. attorney, who works under the auspices of the Department of Justice, Merrick Garland's Department of Justice, which serves under the executive branch of the federal government at the behest of Mr. Joseph Robinette Biden. You have a responsibility to turn that over without it being asked for of you. Do you realize that? The legal precedent was set in a case called Brady versus Maryland, and then there are accompanying cases like Giglio versus the United States that requires prosecutors to turn that evidence over to the defense even if they never ask for it. I can tell you, it is a matter of course. Every case I've handled, if I ever have Brady information or anything remotely approaching Brady, it is an institutional practice in every district attorney's office I've practiced in to turn it over immediately. You would literally draft a document called Brady Disclosures to also file a record with the court documenting the fact that you have provided this information, provided this evidence to the defense, even if you know the evidence cannot be used at trial. I want everybody to understand that. Every mentor, every teacher, every instructor has always trained baby DAs that if it's remotely close, you turn it over. Now, why are you instructed and trained that way? Because if you fail to turn over Brady information, at a minimum, you will jeopardize whatever case you're handling that would guarantee to a particular defendant a new trial, regardless of how the case pans out, even in instances where a plea bargain was entered. At worst, if it's determined that the Brady information was withheld intentionally, you could lose your law license, and in some instances, maybe face criminal penalties yourself. Brady material to prosecutors always is flashing red lights. Do not pass go. Do not collect $200. If you think it could be remotely close, you turn it over. Because my job as a prosecutor is not to secure convictions. People don't understand this. My job as a prosecutor is to secure that justice is done. So my job is to vigorously prosecute a case as well as try as best as possible to protect the record to ensure whatever I do sticks. And it will be upheld regardless of what levels of scrutiny are applied to it. Remember I had that question? Well, Tucker Carlson invited Jacob Chansley's attorney onto his program, showed him the footage again, and asked him on national television, had you seen this before? I want you to watch this and listen to this clip. It is longer than the clips we usually play, but I thought it was important for you to see all of it. It's clip number one. Go.
And through each of those three hearings, that government assistant U.S. attorney knew the most important aspect of that hearing was that Jake was not violent. The government knew. They knew that Jake had walked around with all of these police officers. They had that video footage. I didn't get it. It wasn't disclosed to me. It wasn't provided to me. I requested it. I filed the requisite pleading for it, and whether I did or not, they had a duty, an absolute duty, with zero discretion to provide it to me so that I could share it with my client.
Very simple question. It's shocking that this could happen and happen with the knowledge of Liz Cheney and Adam Kinzinger and Chuck Schumer and all the ghouls around the story. How can this man still be in prison tonight? He's still in jail tonight, right now.
Well, it's a tragedy. I mean, what's happened is truly a dagger in the heart of our American justice system. We can't allow it. And but for you disclosing it, and whether this isn't about you, this isn't about January 6th. This is about our justice system being so compromised. The very integrity and core of that which we wore as a badge of honor for the entirety of our nation's history has been rendered a vile, disgusting mess by a Department of Justice that was running amok. And they didn't share the video of my client, the footage of my client with 9 officers surrounding him peacefully, wandering about, trying to help him, trying to get him access to the Senate chamber. They didn't because it didn't fit their narrative. And but for you disclosing it, I don't know where we'd be.
Now, this attorney went on national television. His name is Albert Watkins, to say he never got this footage. He never got this footage. I also want you to understand something. Well, let me say one thing first. There was a great question in the live video feed. Well, does D.C. have different rules considering that it's not a state? No. The standards required under Brady versus Maryland and Giglio versus the United States apply nationwide. All 50 states have the same evidentiary standards as it pertains to Brady material. So, no, there are no differences. The same rules and the same law that I prosecuted under govern this evidence. I want to let you in on something else. There is an attribution principle that applies here. I have personally handled cases where, for example, evidence was secured by the police department, but my case agent, the detective who was operating in my case, wasn't aware that this evidence was in the possession of the police department. Guess what? That doesn't save you. Even if you didn't personally have it in your possession, the institutional knowledge of your department is attributed to you. Now, the thing that would cut against, it would cut against there being an intentional withholding of Brady material. But the reality of the Brady material still being withheld would still apply. I may not face any personal sanctions as an attorney handling the case, but the legitimacy of any conviction obtained under that context will be called into question. Attorney Albert Watkins should file a motion for new trial yesterday, which I'm sure he did. File a motion for new trial. For him to have his client enter a plea agreement without having all of the potentially exculpatory and mitigating evidence at his disposal that would allow him to provide proper legal counsel to his client is a fundamental. This is not complicated. This is a fundamental violation of the responsibility that attorneys have as agents of the court for a prosecutor to have this. And I'm not saying the assistant U.S. attorney handling the case even had this evidence. I'm not saying they did. But clearly, this was in the possession of the government. Which brings another question to mind. With all of the pageantry and the production that was done by the January 6th committee, you want to tell me they never had access to this information? And then you got cats like Benny Thompson from Mississippi, who was the chairman of the committee. He's saying, none of us on the committee actually saw the videos. Our staff reviewed it. Boy, you lying, boy. Here's what I'm saying you're lying about. I don't doubt that you didn't watch all of the videos, but to hide behind your staff? Because see, what's going on here, shout out to my man Billy Davis in American Family News. Whenever you have people that are guilty of crimes, they're much rather fall on the sword of incompetence and laziness as opposed to having to deal with the accountability for the actual criminality of their conduct. You don't get to hide behind the fact, well, my staff reviewed it. You're the chairman of the January 6th committee. So you don't you ain't have time to watch the videos, but you got time to get on TV and talk about I'm from the state of Mississippi. Guys, this is this if there is discovered evidence of intentional concealment of this, people need to be going to jail straight up. At a minimum, every defendant who's been charged, if there's anybody in custody currently, they need to be filing motion for immediate release under bond if they haven't been tried yet. If you have people that have pled, they need to be filing motions for new trial. If you have people who have been tried, you need to be filing motions for new trial because evidence that is core to your potential defense was withheld from you. This, wow, is all I can say. I didn't want to assume that the attorney didn't have the information. But for him to go on national TV, because it's very easy to disprove that. As a prosecutor, if I turn over Brady evidence, I have receipts. I file my notice to the court that I've turned over this evidence, and I detail in my notice what exactly it is I gave to the defense. You can't pull that on me if I'm having to handle the case because I have the file-stamped document that records everything that was turned over. It's a very simple issue to resolve. Very simple. And then now I want to get to the heft of the moment when Attorney Watkins said that they did not allow this information, this evidence, this video evidence to be overturned, to be turned over to them because it did not comport with their narrative. You literally have the highest governmental apparatus again. And I'm saying again because do I need to remind you of what happened with the FBI? With the falsification of documents under oath before the FISA court in order to start the whole Russian collusion investigation. And now you have the Department of Justice, which I will remind you, the FBI serves under the auspices of the Department of Justice, literally operating as a political entity, not merely to influence an outcome of an election in this instance, but to deprive American citizens of their liberty. Do you understand what is happening here? You have the entire scope, breadth, weight, and funded by, should I remind you, by your tax dollars and mine, utilized to turn the full scope and weight of that against American citizens. I've said before, criminal trespassing is a crime. If it can be demonstrated, you have people that have forcibly made entry into the Capitol, they should be held accountable. I'm not saying even the QAnon shaman that there's nothing if it can be demonstrated that he committed criminal trespass, but there is no way you're going to have a four-year sentence for criminal trespass. And by the way, when Attorney Watkins pointed out that violence was at the core of his particular client's charge, Jacob Chansley, it is because Jacob Chansley was charged with knowingly entering and remaining in any restricted building or grounds without lawful authority and with violent entry and disorderly conduct on Capitol grounds. If you have video evidence that Jacob Chansley is not acting in a violent manner and he is not acting in a disorderly manner on Capitol grounds, guess what you just have on video? Exculpatory evidence. It is high time for the American people to wake up as to what's truly happening. I don't want to be hyperbolic, but this is grounds, in my opinion, for impeachment to be lobbed towards Merrick Garland. This is grounds for the January 6th committee members to face impeachment because you're willing to turn a blind eye to incarcerate American citizens under false pretenses and conceal that evidence from the American public because it does not fit your narrative? This is unconscionable. And now you have tangible video evidence to sustain it. And if the Republicans did not win back the House of Representatives, do you think we ever would even found this out? Guys, Christ truly is our only hope. Truly.
Forget about Facebook.
The last 10 days we've been banned twice, and is unbanning a word?
They put us under the ban. Christians and conservatives
don't need you, YouTube.
Banned one day, banned again.
AFR programs are now live streaming on the AFA streaming app. Now you can get shows like Today's Issues straight from the source.
Put back on the next.
Just say unbanned.
Unbanned.
Just search AFA streaming or visit streaming.afa.net to sign up.
Hi, this is Pastor Robert Morris. I'm often asked, how do I grow in my relationship with the Lord? How do I hear God? What is God's plan and purpose for me? I want to personally invite you to join me on Sunday mornings right here on AFR for worship and the Word. And we will discover the answer to these questions together. We'll explore the truths found in God's Word that will help you strengthen your faith and develop a more intimate relationship with Him.
Revival Part 2. This is David Wheaton, host of The Christian Worldview. Revival takes place when God enlivens believers to greater holiness, obedience, and service, which then leads to greater proclamation of the gospel and non-believers being saved. Every Christian should pray for and pursue revival personally and within their church, accomplished through the ordinary means that God ordains, such as the preaching of Scripture, rather than crafting emotional methods to stimulate a certain response. Paul told Timothy, "Preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with great patience and instruction." This is how the greatest revivals began. Hear part two of our most recent program on revival at thechristianworldview.org and then tune in this weekend for another topic that will sharpen your worldview.
Listen to The Christian Worldview with David Wheaton, Saturday mornings at 8 Central on American Family Radio.
Hello, Americans. I'm Todd Starnes. Stand by for news and commentary next.
Take advantage of the warmer weather and come explore Liberty University's campus, ranked number 4 best college campus in America by niche.com. Join us for Experience LU, an all-day event that shows off our dorm rooms, classrooms, and award-winning dining hall. Or, if you're short on time, attend a 4-hour student-led campus tour to hit the highlights. To learn more or schedule your visit to Liberty University, text VISIT LU to 49596. Again, that's VISIT LU to 49596.
The Biden administration honored a man on International Women's Day. Alba Ruida is a man who identifies as a woman from Argentina, honored at a White House ceremony for women of courage. First Lady Jill Biden beamed from ear to ear as Mr. Ruida accepted his award. The White House says he was kicked out of classrooms, refused jobs, and was rejected by his family. All unfortunate circumstances. But the truth is, Mr. Ruida is not a woman. The White House literally diminished biological women and instead pushed a transgender agenda. The Republican National Hispanic Assembly called the award disgraceful and unacceptable. The White House seems to believe men make better women than biological women do. And I can't think of a better time than International Women's Day to remind you, good listeners, that Democrats can't even tell you what a woman is. I'm Todd Starnes.
The Hamilton Quarter podcast and one-minute commentaries are available at AFR.net. Back to the Hamilton Quarter on American Family Radio.
Welcome back to the Hamilton Corner. Abraham Hamilton III here. Man, I have so much more to say. But today's show, I'm pretty sure everybody understood in the first segment when I referred to the scripture in Nahum, when I say warfare is within the purview of men. I'm talking about kinetic hot warfare on the ground. I'm not saying women have any role, but not on the front lines. And I'm saying to you, the scripture asserts that notion, or supports it, I should say. A little foolishness du jour from the state of Mississippi today. The state of Mississippi was considering legislation yesterday. It's gone through the process, House Bill 1315, which is a bill that sought to protect minors in the state of Mississippi from pornography. The House bill made it over to the Senate side in the state of Mississippi. Senator Angela Hill, a friend of the program and a friend of the entire AFR network, added an amendment in committee that will remove the existing obscenity exemption for public school libraries in the state. Now, I want to mention something to you. Obscenity is a type of pornography that is the worst of the worst, that even the Supreme Court has said matters deemed obscene are not afforded First Amendment protections. just to give you a scope of what we're talking about. And the existing law in Mississippi exempted libraries, school libraries, from being prohibited from having this material accessible to minors. Senator Hill sought to correct this error. Well, the bill made its way to the floor of the Mississippi State Legislature yesterday, and 27 Mississippi senators voted to remove the amendment from the bill, effectively saying, nah, we want to make sure minors can still access obscene material in school libraries. Now, you tell me what kind of sickness that is. In red as Mississippi is, 27 senators are going to vote to allow minors to access this obscene material in school libraries. I'm going to give you their names. The ones who voted to strip Senator Hill's amendment are Senators Blackmun, Blackwell, Blunt, Boyd, Bryan, Senator Albert Butler, Senator Kelvin Butler, Senator Carter, Senator Chassaniel, Senator Barr, Delano, Senator Frazier, Senator Hickman, Senator Hobson, Senator Horn, Senator Johnson, Senator Thomas, Senator Thompson, Senator Turner Ford, and Senator Wiggins. All 27 of them, and I forgot to mention Senators Jordan, Senators Michelle, Senator Moran, Senator Norwood, Senator Polk, Senator Derek T. Simmons, Senator Sarita Simmons. They all voted to remove Senator Hill's amendment. And I'm sharing that with you if you're listening to me in the state of Mississippi, so you can call your state senator and have a nice conversation with them to ask, why do you want our children accessing obscene materials in school libraries? Man, I'm just sick of the smut, man. I'm just sick of the smut. Now, I'm going to tell you what probably is a motivating factor is that you have various business interests that say, hey, I want you to vote against this thing. But it's just sickening to me that these kinds of things happen. So why don't you go ahead and give your senators a call and ask them, do you think our children should be accessing obscene materials in school libraries? It's crazy, man. It's crazy. But wait, there's more. Dr. Robert Redfield testified before Congress yesterday at the House Select Subcommittee on the Coronavirus Pandemic. Another phenomenon that has occurred because the Republicans have taken over the House of Representatives in Congress. Dr. Robert Redfield is the former director of the CDC. Dr. Redfield, early on in the fallout from Schmovid, based on his expertise, came to the conclusion, it was his opinion, I should say it better, he came to the hypothesis that it was most likely, in his view, that Schmovid came from a leak in the Wuhan lab. Dr. Redfield said he shared his opinions rather candidly, and as a result, the former NIAID director, Dr. Anthony Fauci, the boy from Brooklyn, and National Institutes of Health director Francis Collins excluded him from a conference call concerning the origins of COVID. I want you to listen to this video and watch it for yourself. This is Dr. Redfield testifying under oath yesterday. Clip 3. Go.
Dr. Redfield, I want to stick with you. You have said before that you were locked out of conversations about the lab leak by Dr. Fauci and Dr. Collins. Do you think they kept you out of the conversations because you believe COVID-19 may have come from a lab?
Yeah, I think I made it very clear in January to all of them why we had to aggressively pursue this, and I let them know as a virologist that I didn't see that this was anything like SARS or MERS because they never learned how to transmit human to human. That I felt this virus was too infectious for humans. There was a lot of evidence that lab actually published in 2014 that they put the H2 receptor into humanized mice so it could infect human tissue. I think, you know, we had to really seriously go after the fact it came from the lab, and they knew that that was how I was thinking, although I thought we had to go after both hypotheses. And I was told later I didn't know I was excluded. I didn't know there was a February 1st conference call until the Freedom of Information came out with the emails, and I was quite upset as the CDC director that I was excluded from those discussions.
Why would they do this?
Because I had a different point of view, and I was told they made a decision that they would keep this confidential until they came up with a single narrative, which I will argue is antithetical to science. Science never selects a single narrative. We foster, as my colleague here just said, we foster debate. Mm-hmm. And we're confident that with debate, science will eventually get to the truth. This was an a priori decision that there's one point of view that we're going to put out there, and anyone who doesn't agree with it is going to be sidelined. And as I say, I was only the CDC director,
right,
and I was sidelined. Right. And I was sidelined.
Now think about that. Dealing with an infectious disease, the director of the United States Center for Disease Control and Prevention was excluded from conferencing because of his opinion. And as you heard him say, this is antithetical to science. Because in science, well, you don't pick a narrative and say, I'm going to go with that one. The point of science, remember Fauci said, I am science. The point of science is to provoke debate. Yet, this man was excluded. This is nothing new. I'm going to show you something now that this isn't new. Dr. Redfield has been saying this for a long time. Digging through the crates, I was able to find a 2021 video that Dr. Redfield did for CNN where he said the exact same thing. It's clip number 4. Go.
If I was to guess, this virus started transmitting somewhere in September, October in Wuhan.
September, October.
That's my own view. It's an only opinion. I'm allowed to have opinions now. You know, I am of the point of view that I still think the most likely etiology of this pathogen in Wuhan was from a laboratory, escaped. Other people don't believe that. That's fine. Science will eventually figure it out. It's not unusual for respiratory pathogens that are being worked on in a laboratory to infect a laboratory worker.
It is also not unusual for that type of research to be occurring in Wuhan. The city is a widely known center for viral studies in China, including the Wuhan Institute of Virology, which has experimented extensively with bat coronaviruses.
It is a remarkable conversation I feel like we're having here, because you are the former CDC director and you were the director at the time this was all happening.
For the first time, the former CDC director is stating publicly that he believes this pandemic started months earlier than we knew, and that it originated not at a wet market, but inside a lab in China.
These are two significant things to say, Dr. Redfield.
That's not implying any intentionality. You know, it's my opinion, right? But I am a virologist. I have spent my life in virology. I do not believe this somehow came from a bat to a human. And at that moment in time, the virus that came to the human became one of the most infectious viruses that we know in humanity for human-to-human transmission. Normally, when a pathogen goes from a zoonotic to human, it takes a while for it to figure out how to become more and more efficient in human-to-human transmission. I just don't think this makes biological sense.
I just don't think this makes any biological sense. MERS, no human-to-human transmission. SARS, no human-to-human transmission. But all of a sudden, this one? Now, this is in 2021. Don't you think for every Fauci interview, we should have had a Dr. Robert Redfield interview if we were interested in discerning the truth? If CNN had this footage, why didn't we have more Dr. Robert Redfield interviews? Guys, I'm telling you, the books will cook. I have so much more to say, but I want to play another audio clip for you. Because in Dr. Redfield's testimony before Congress yesterday, he explained there were three things that transpired. I'm going to try to unpack them as quick as I can with the remaining time that conveyed to him, that was persuasive to him, oh, no, 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 no. This is a lab phenomenon. Three things that took place. Clip number two. Go.
That I will say, if you go back and look, it's declassified now. And I'm sure you all have your classified briefings. But the declassified information now, in September of 2019, three things happened in that lab. One is they deleted the sequences. It was highly irregular. So researchers don't usually like to do that. Second thing they did was they changed the command and control of the lab from the civilian control to the military control. Highly unusual, and I've been involved in dual use labs when I was in the military. And the third things they did, which I think is really telling, is they let a contractor redo the ventilation system in that laboratory. So I think clearly there was strong evidence that there was a significant event that happened in that laboratory in September. It's now been declassified. You can read it. I'm sure there's more classified information around.
There's so much I'm going to try to unpack. If I don't get it all out, I'll have to pick this up later on. First, deleting the sequences. The New York Times reported that early in the pandemic, over 200 data entries from the genetic sequencing of early cases of COVID-19 in Wuhan were erased from an online scientific database. This is what Dr. Redfield is talking about. The early suspicion was that these sequences were deleted because they revealed that the virus that ravaged the world may have predated the alleged outbreak at the wet market in December 2019. That's what Dr. Redfield is talking about. Researchers don't delete sequences. So why all of a sudden these sequences are getting deleted? Jesse Bloom, a virologist at the Fred Hutchinson Cancer Center in Seattle, was able to track down 13 of the deleted sequences online and determined that, quote, it seems likely that the sequences were deleted to obscure their existence, end quote. What existence, you say? That this virus was percolating way longer than the popular narrative wanted to say. Chinese researchers requested, listen to this, requested that the National Institutes of Health in the United States delete the sequences, and the NIH complied with it. Why would the NIH in America comply with what's going with the Chinese researchers' request to delete it? Oh, probably because we were funding the research. The second change, Dr. Redfield noted, they changed the command and control at the lab from civilian to military control, which Dr. Redfield said is highly unusual. In 2021, Representative Michael McCaul, Republican from Texas, noted during a meeting of the Select Subcommittee on the Coronavirus Crisis, quote, new testimony now received by my committee reveals the Chinese military potentially took over this lab, not in January 2020 as was reported, but earlier in 2019, even as early as 2017. There's more to say on that. I'll give you the third one. The third thing Dr. Redfield said that was telling was that the lab, all of a sudden, let a contractor redo the ventilation system in the laboratory. Why would you need to do that? He goes on to explain, so I think clearly there was strong evidence that a significant event happened in that laboratory in September, which led Dr. Redfield to ruffle feathers when he came out in the 2021 clip I showed you to say, you know what? This thing doesn't look like it's naturally occurring at all. And Dr. Fauci and Francis Collins said, you know what? You may be the head of the Center for Disease Control and Prevention in the United States of America, but we're not going to let you get in the way of our agenda. So you won't even be involved in the meeting that Dr. Redfield didn't even find out about until a Freedom of Information Act request was filed. That's how he learned that Fauci and Collins excluded him from the meeting.
The views and opinions expressed in this broadcast may not necessarily reflect those of the American Family Association.